talking about a new masonry model, which will be coming in the next version available. Let's start. Everybody should be able to see my screen, and maybe in the bottom a little bit of an other thing, but that doesn't matter. This webinar will be about a new masonry model. It's implemented in Vienna. Also, we go briefly through some simplified zone models and some other linear and nonlinear dynamic material models you can use for your earthquake designs. This is mainly because we updated not only the new engineering masonry model, but also some soil models, concrete models, interface models, all to get a better workflow for the earthquake design with Vienna. At last, I will show you a few slides on a new proposed workflow for the nonlinear time history earthquake approaches. Let's first give some background about the reason why we are putting a lot of energy in making life easier for earthquake designs. That's partly because of the situation in northern of Holland, where we have some natural gas subtraction from the soil, and at about 3 kilometers depth there are some earthquake events that tend to get bigger, and that's why we need more earthquake designs and retrofiction of the current housing, as you can see on these pictures. 2012, the largest event up to now, did have a magnitude of about 3.6, but because it is at a low depth, only so a 3 kilometer, around 3 kilometer, the peak ground acceleration is rather high, and according to the new guidelines in Holland, we don't have an annex of the Eurocode yet, but the new guideline is saying we need to have a design PGA of about 0.5 to sometimes with safety factors 1G, so that is quite a lot. The main housing in Holland area is brick masonry wall, but also concrete building elements are there and steel. The culture in Holland of making housing is like depicted here on the photograph, a calcium silicate brick inside, where also the beams, the wooden, mostly wooden beams or hollow core slabs, concrete hollow core slabs, are put on. So the vertical loading parts is the inner calcium silicate brick of about 100 millimeter. Then we have a cavity wall, yes or no, filled with some insulation material, can also be just air. And then we have an outside 100 millimeter clay brick. The connection between those two leaves is mainly with wall ties, and it's varying a lot depending on the building age, etc., how many wall ties there are and whether they are yes or no corroded and can have still a function or not. At least these buildings, you can say they are not designed for earthquakes. Well, to model these kind of walls, you can do a micro approach by modeling all stones, all bricks, and making a linear or an interface around each brick. But of course, that's a lot of work, and also it takes a lot of computer consuming time. So we are more happy from an engineering point of view with a smeared approach, where we don't take into account the size of the bricks in our shells, in our materials. We want to have a smeared approach. This material model we made is taking into account a non-orthogonal material, and is mainly based on shells, so not on volume 3D elements, but works on shells. So you can model the inner cavity leaf and the outer leaf as two separate shells and make the wall ties with interfaces if you want, or a surface interface between those two leaves. Then each leaf you can give this material, and you have to specify a local element direction, because as you can see on the left upper side of the screen, you see the wall being vertically, normally vertically made, but your elements in your model are not always vertically orientated, of course. Sometimes you have elements which are made under an angle, especially where you have connections and an automatic meshing procedure, you will find it. So the first thing to do is be sure that the local element axis is set to the right direction. The right direction for the local x-axis is normally in the global horizontal direction. So that's either x or global y normally. And your local y direction, the vertical one, will be in your global z direction. The reason for doing is, this is that our model takes into account the Coulomb friction behavior depending on your vertical stress. You will find more resistance in more or less resistance in the horizontal sliding. Then the main features I will talk about is the tensile behavior, how it's implemented in this model, the compression or crushing behavior, the second one, and the third one, the Coulomb-based shear retention. I have to say that this model is developed at the Diana FEA, but not alone. We did it together with the users mainly in Holland, but especially the TU Delft with Jan Rots and his PhD students. The main difference you can see already on the graph on the left bottom side are this is a model validation test made in a university where they prescribe displacement horizontal to a wall in plane section, and they measure the displacement on the lower side of the diagram and the force to do that, force that displacement on the vertical graph title. And what you can see is that there is a linear unloading reloading sequence, and that's what you can see in the graph is making the aesthetic behavior and the energy loops within those lines. That's the main difference with this material from a normal total strain crack model. The total strain crack model does not take into account firstly the orthotropy of the masonry material itself, and it does not allow for linear unloading. It's only loading secants. So if you use the total strain crack model, for instance, with a rotating axis of a fixed axis system, you will not see the hysteretic loops as you saw before in the graph. Although the amount of force necessary and the failure curve to take the in-plane or out-of-plane wall to failure is described very well with a total strain crack model. The only thing is, if you unload and reload it, there's not any energy consumed by sliding, for instance. The new model is a total strain based continuum model. that covers, as I told before, the tensile, the shear, and the compression failure modes, and also the unloading and reloading part. In the XY horizontal vertical bed joint and head joint system is artificial in the model. So you don't have to model all the bricks. It's a smeared crack approach, but it is taking into account the vertical stresses and the sliding energy or maximum force will be adapted to the vertical loads, either the dead weight of the building or an extra load out of the earthquake dynamics. For instance, if you have a set component where the building is going up and tends to get less weight, your horizontal sliding, of course, capacity will be less. With the adequate hysteresis loops for all the different aspects of failure modes, tensile, crushing and sliding, you will observe all the energy hysteresis loops that we need to describe the energy that is absorbed during the NLTH analysis. Any orthotropy gives you the opportunity to give a material dependent on the direction. So in the X direction and Y direction, local, horizontal, vertical, you can give different Young Mullally tensile strength compression strength. Then going to the input. First, you have to fill in some elastic input, that is the Young's modulus. You can see here it's a local X direction and a Y direction. The asterisk in the new Diana 10 GUI means that it is obligatory to fill in a value. There's no default value. According to literature, there is a kind of correlation between the vertical and the horizontal Young's modulus. For clay brick and calcium brick, you can see that in the bottom part of the screen. According to literature, for clay brick it should be around 2 and calcium silica brick around 1.5. Well, there are tests performed at the university in Holland, and they of course have some different outcome, that's always with these kind of tests, but the TU Eindhoven, University of Eindhoven, is close to literature, and the TU Delft, some replicated masonry, tend to have a slightly different correlation between the vertical and horizontal Young Mullally. Of course, it is still under investigation at the universities. The new material model allows you to fill in your own correlation between the horizontal and vertical stiffness. Then also the shear modulus can be given and the mass of density. Next thing is the tensile strength. The tensile strength in X direction, so that is horizontally normally, tends to be higher than the vertical one, and with a factor of around roughly 1/3 or 1/2 for the different kind of bricks. So here is a typical example. The element X has direction 0.12 MPa and the Y direction vertical 0.04 MPa. And in you can also give, or you need to give in the GF, the amount of energy under the graph to be able to predict the ultimate strain. And the ultimate strain is calculated, as you can see on the right top of the screen, by having 2 times the amount of energy divided by the crack bandwidth and the tensile strength. Then you have the area under the graph. Sometimes it's necessary, or it's even, depending on the kind of bricks, handy and or necessary to give in a residual tensile strength. That's not obligatory because, of course, you can say after the ultimate strain, your tensile strength is just zero, like in the graph depicted. But after the ultimate strain, you can also higher this last branch a little bit, up to, for instance, 10% of the tensile strength, the original tensile strength. And you can see that the unloading reloading is just here a simple secant unloading reloading because there is not much energy further in that opening and closing of the cracks. So the tensile region is there, but the amount of hysteresis energy in that opening and closing is not that high. For the compression, that can be different. For the compression, you have to fill in, again, the compression strength, of course, in the X and Y direction. On the left bottom, you see again the literature values and the values measured at the universities of Holland. And normally the Y direction is a little bit stronger than the horizontal direction. Any amount of energy you can also fill in. The amount of energy does something that is important in that sense, that as you can see from the graph, it's a kind of parabolic behavior from zero compression strength up to the maximum compression strength. And after that, we need a linear unloading branch up to the ultimate strain. Well, if the amount of energy is not high enough, then that linear softening branch up to the maximum compressive strain will be just vertical. And that means an abrupt, sudden drop in the capacity, and that can lead to ill numerical conditions or bad conversions. So it's always good to check whether your amount of energy is that high that at least this linear softening branch after the strain peak is a little bit not vertical but descending with a certain slope. We're still thinking of making this a block override. If you fill in a too low energy curve, then we could give a warning and we are setting a minimal slope to get a better convergence. That's of course what user can do itself, but also as a program you can give a warning to the user that you are doing that to help him. What we observed from all the tests done in the university is that with a simple parabolic curve you cannot get the right behavior under compression for the masonry bricks. So what we did is we prolonged the peak strain a little bit more than you naturally would expect from a parabolic shape. So this peak strain is defined with a factor, the factor to strain at compressive strength, where that factor is the Young's modulus divided by the compressive strength, so the linear branch up to failure. And that strain is multiplied with this factor. You can see it here in the formula on the top of the screen. N is Young's modulus times the peak divided by the compression strength. So that means that this ultimate peak is prolonged a little bit more far than you would expect normally. A typical default value for that factor, or advised value, it's not default, but it's advised from the tests we did at the university, to have that at a factor of 4. So 4 times the linear branch up to failure, So if you go from zero and you take a straight line up to the maximum compressive stress, then that strain is multiplied by 4. And then you see here from the graph that you can go down the slope after the ultimate peak. And if you then would observe a unloading or somewhere else at the branch, of course, you can load unload linearly, only partly or total. Well, and that is that last parameter, unloading factor. 1 is secant, 0 is linear, and I filled in a 0.2 to describe this graph you see on the screen. So if you would have filled in 1 as being secant, then you go from everywhere on a graph with a straight line to 0, as with the total strain model, and you have no energy absorption at all. If you fill in 0, you unload into the horizontal x-axis, so to a stress of 0, and then go back to 0 and can unload again, and then you will observe the most energy absorption, of course, and you can fill in everything in between, like here at 0.2, or maybe it's more 0.3, as you can see in the graph. You unload to this factor of the compression strength, and then go back to 0, and if you reload again, you will secretly reload up to the slope where you have been before, and you follow the material curve again. And the area in this triangle, the triangle from unloading, going back and reloading, is the amount of energy you observe each time you do this. I will make a comment later on how much energy we see in the models that is observed in this crushing zones. It's not too much, I have to say. Much more important is seems to be the model shear and sliding, where we have a friction model with a friction angle and a cohesion value, just like a Coulomb friction, and an amount of energy under the graph to get an ultimate strain again. This is not obligatory. We can also say you don't fill it in, and then it will go on. There's an extra checkbox. If there is a crack in that element, you can reduce the cohesion to 0. That's normally what happens in reality as well, that if the masonry is cracked, of course you don't have any cohesion left anymore. You can see here how the tail max is described. So linear elastic from 0 to the tail max, it's the cohesion minus the Tangens, the sigma yy, so the vertical stress you could say normally, times the Tangens V, friction angle. That's a normal Coulomb friction formula. The ultimate strain is given by the amount of energy divided by crack vent width and the cohesion. Plus, of course, the vertical stress that gives more strain capacity. Once you have walked through during your loading this part of the tau, so you've left all your cohesion and it's gone, then for the unloading you will not get back at it, of course. So once you have eaten up the energy of the energy of cohesion is gone, and the next loading, unloading will go flat without cohesion. This graph displays loading up to tau max, then descending branch up to a vertical strength stress times the friction angle. That will hold, of course, up into eternally. And if you unload it, you go to the other regime you should You can so say left right normally in the masonry terms. It's not minus plus but left right, and you come to the branch. If you've not been there before, then from zero you go up the cohesion again, and if you've been through the cohesion part before already, then the branch is prolonged horizontally just with the normal stress TYY, vertical stress times tangens phi. With our new masonry model and our new version that's coming up, we also made a new crack band width specification. As you all know, might know that we had a crack band width definition of having the area of the elements square rooted or in three dimensional deferred power. Now we implemented another model according to Coffin-Yeh, where the direction of the stress is taken into account. So your shape factor of the elements, you could say, if they are not squared, is taken into account as well as the direction of the stress. We would advise to use this crack band width in combination with this material model. So then we come to suggested correlation, because if you have a more advanced model, you need to have more parameters to fill in, of course, and it can sometimes be confusing what to fill in, and that's why we try to guide the users somewhere where they don't have test results or where the results are unclear. Then you can make use of these tables, where we say the vertical Young's modulus is about 2 times or 1.5, depending on the kind of brick, of the horizontal Young's modulus for the compression strength is the same, and for the tension strength, strength is 1/3 or 1.5. Then all these values are seen before, because I filled them in as an example on the previous slides. They are coming from some validation tests of the TU Delft, University of Delft. And I did not express before that you can also add still some small strain damping to the material, like 1 or maximum 2%. Of course, normally, if you have material hysteresis, you can say all your damping is in your material hysteresis, but we observe that that's not always the case when it behaves linear elastic or still in the small strain part of the material. And that's why you can still add some percentages of strain damping. Well, then all over universities, they have done a lot of tests in the past. Not are all well described, but some are. And together with our Dutch gas extractor NAM Shell, there's done a lot of extra research in Italy at the EU Center, and for instance in the University of Delft in Holland, with shear panels. So panels with a different length to height ratio, smaller piers and wider walls, you can say. And typically there are two kind of walls that are tested, clamped or cantilever ones. If you have a pier or a wall that has not much overburden stress, so not much weight on it, not a high building, just for instance a one level building, you can say it's more like a cantilever. And when it's a higher building, three stories high, etc., or heavy loads on it, then your overburden stress is much more, and you tend to go to a clamped pier or wall. Of course, the outcome is different, and both need to be described, well described by the material model. That's why they are both tested. So the slenderness is the length to edge ratio and being clamped or cantilevered. And there's variance of the overburden stress on top of the walls. Well, Diana has made a validation document together with its users, mainly the Dutch users, and we're still working on that before the next version is coming available to have that validation report as a second version. Well, here's some examples. This is the test LOSTAR. It's a test that's done earlier. It's an old one already, and you can see the test result in plain cyclic with the red curves in the graph going up to a maximum capacity of around 80 kilonewtons with a horizontal drift or displacement of 3 millimeters for the first maximum cycle, and then you observe that the cohesion is getting less and less, and with the fourth bigger cycle, you can say, you tend to come at a horizontal branch of around 50-60 kilonewtons. You can describe that with our new masonry model by giving a little bit cohesion and a reduction to the cohesion with energy, yes or no. And then you can also observe the horizontal branch at the larger displacements and the larger curves. As you can see from this graph, as well as the initial stiffness, you can see it here at the red graph. It's this first more thicker lines where they are overlaying on each other. And in the model, the blue graph, you can see observe as well the linear elastic stiffness behavior. And later on, it tends to get less stiff, of course. The amount of energy under the graph is well described and about the same. On the bottom, with the colored pictures, you can see the different stadia. So the first picture on the left bottom is the maximum displacement to the right, then the maximum displacement to the left, in the middle, and the end. The right picture is the end of the model test, where you can see cracks are observed, sliding cracks on top and on bottom, and some cracks are going from left to right, top down. And on the right, you can see also the cracks that were observed in the tests. For a wider sliding wall, so the length to edge ratio that's a little bit different, you can also observe a different behavior. The more wider walls will have this typical behavior where you have a little bit of cohesion and then you come into a sliding zone of the top or bottom of the wall. And you can see in the bottom right picture that the cracks are all along the bottom part of the wall, and the wall is indeed sliding during larger strains. The behavior of the energy each time you go from right to left is described in this hysteretic loops. From these loops you can see that the amount of energy that is absorbed is much more than only under compression. Now, we're still, there are a lot of more tests that we validated and that we described. We hope we get them in the validation document version 2 before the coming release of 10.1, where this material model will be in the DNA available in the dynamic models. We're also testing what element size and what element type would be most suitable to use for these kind of analysis, because quadratics tends to describe the strains normally better, but with dynamic behavior, sometimes the linear types have more advantages, and maybe it's better to get a little bit smaller linear ones than fewer quadratic ones. As you can see here on the left, if you have small elements, just 100 millimeter for a wall building, that's rather small. For these small component tests, it's okay to do that. But if you have a big building with all elements of 100 millimeter, you have a big computational effort for nonlinear dynamic behavior, of course. You see the quadratic and linear elements can describe the test more than well. And are about the same. On the right hand, you see when you make the the elements bigger, the linear ones, that's the red curve, tends to consume a little bit more energy than the quadratic ones. So we have to keep that in mind, and we're still investigating whether that's too much or not, and what can be as a guidance for the users in the future. Just to show what kind of buildings we have in Holland and what you can do with it. This is a typical apartment building with masonry walls, four-story high. And you can see the different failure modes in the small graphs. Another school that is typically in one direction stiffer than the other direction, where the walls in plane tend to have more stiffness and more strength, and the wall from left to right in the X direction tends to have much less stiffness and strength. So it's a dominant mode in that direction, and we're still working on getting nice cracks under 45 degrees with this new masonry model. The failure border or height can be described well. The energy consumption can be described well for sliding and crushing, but the cracks tend to be too steep according or comparing with the university tests. We hope to get that more enhanced before the version released. Well, what did we observe in those cases and some more cases we have been doing lately is that in the tensile and compression reaching for a total building, the aesthetic energy absorption is not too much. For tensile regime, you can imagine, because the value of crack energy is very small, so then you don't have any energy in the material already. For compression, you have seen those energy curves, the loop in the graph, that could be big, but in reality there is only a very small zone and a few elements in a total building that is failing under compression. And because it's just a small zone, it's again not too much energy that is absorbed there. Therefore, we write it here that shear sliding is much more important. It seems that the sliding tends to absorb much more energy than under compression. What is correlation with this is the compression curve. If you're calculating with the linear unloading branch, Diana sometimes with a total building has some problems to converge completely. And if you want to help Diana with converging to the value, then it's possible with the new masonry model to put the compression zone on secant, when you observe that in your model only a few elements are failing under compression. And normally we see that, and then you say, I only want the energy in the sliding. Well, then there are some related aspects to the masonry model, of course, some other dynamics. I will go very fast through them because there's a masonry model webinar. You can read it after later in the digital version you can download. That's for the workflow and the relevance of the soil structure interaction effects. If you have a building, of course you want to keep the relation between the energy absorbed put in the model on the bottom on this left figure at the bottom with a damper. We put normally a force in underneath the model, then through the soil energy absorbed, and a certain amount of energy comes to the building. To be able to describe this, we use a force as an input. We calculate the damping values according to the speed of the bedrock. And the amount of input force and energy is reduced, especially in the lower frequencies, by the failure, shear failure of the soil. And you can see different material models, simple material models we have implemented in Indiana, Arning Drenovich, Ramberg Osgood, and also the geo curves, as we call them, the shear strain stiffness ratio diagrams. We now, for the new version, make it available to combine these simple soil model with a small strain option, because the disadvantage of this model is that the Young's model is vertical, Young's model is bulk model is just linear elastic, and of course you also want to have some non-linearity in your vertical Young's model. That's why we added a small strain model, where you can say we have a certain GO, a certain shear stiffness at start point, and that is holding up till a certain percentage of the shear strain, and after that it will step to the Harding-Drenovich material model. What you typically can observe in the soil column, which you can where you can add your different soil layers, you can see where your strain is more and where your energy is absorbed, mostly at different top-down materials, so at a border of going from one material to another. We also made some comparisons between modeling the total soil underneath the building, or for a building on crate, just model a small piece of the soil and the rest with one D column, as mentioned in our previous webinar. So I won't go over it again. Then, to help the workflow better for the earthquake designs, we also made new interface behavior that include plasticity and hysteretic behavior. For instance, when you want to combine a building on crate, you can put an interface with plasticity underneath it, or when you have a building on pals, you can use these interfaces between the pal and the soil, and the pal tip and the soil. We also included new springs material, which include a yield plateau and then linear unloading reloading in order to have energy absorption as well. Then we are working for 10.1 on Coulomb friction 1D springs as well. This is for the pals. I told before, where you can have a maximum shear force along the pell, and after that shear force, you have a yield plateau, and when you go up, you have linear elastic unloading again, and go up on the left side. In that way, when the pell is going down and went up again in the time signal, it's absorbing energy. We have already created the Mei-Kama model earlier, only there will be a module dynamics from the next version where you can find the Mei-3 model, the soil models, and the Mei-Kama model in one module. You can use them all. This Mei-Kama model typically goes from experiments based material model with a maximum of six cracks in one point, and there's always one crack active. For the steel reinforcements, we also have hysteretic material models, and for the normal steel buildings, we have the modified tooth surface model. That's also in that module available. I will not go into deep into the modified tooth surface model, but as an overview, as an outlook, it's typically described with a plateau, a yielding plateau that is adaptive to your stress and plastic vertical stresses. As being the same for the reinforcement, an adaptive yield plateau. Then, as last slide, we will also have a workflow available in the new version where we automatically or semi-automatically can come from a building on the soil, whether or not there are piles involved, do a first calculation with a time history signal underneath the soil, but with a linear structure, as you can see on the right hand side of the screen, a linear structure, so that calculation is only made for the non-linearities in the soil. And after performing that calculation, the analyst should be able to read out the forces, for instance, on the foundation level, and that are the inertia forces, the damping forces, and the total forces in Diana terms, and we convert that to a model where we make the structure nonlinear, and we leave out the soil, and we put the force underneath that structure. In that way, we can uncouple the calculation, but keep the coupling in the behavior. And that will speed up the calculations, especially for looking at older designs, so housing that's already there, which have to be retrofitted. Then you have to do the calculation of the soil model once, and after that time you can upgrade your building much faster in doing more calculations on the nonlinear structure. Well, then the last slide coming up in autumn, there will be an RC course, and after the RC course there will be an earthquake course, and this course can only be followed for advanced users, and that will be held in 2016 November. Also, a geotechnical course will be held somewhere at the end of the year. I hope you could follow this webinar rather good. If there are any questions, I would propose to raise them, and Yongyang, maybe you can lead us through the questions.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Now we'd like to have a Q&A session. Anyone who has question or discussion, please write in webinar chatting dialog box. If you'd like to use your microphone, please let me know. In case you'd like to ask a question after the session, you can always send us an email. Then we can get back to you. There's one question, any possibility to use this material model in combination with 3D shell element?
Okay, I can answer that. Yes, you can use them for all 3D shell elements. So shell elements is typically a flat or curved shell element that can be in a 3D environment. So for real buildings, the only thing that cannot be done at this moment for this material model is 3D volume elements.
Thanks, Seb. The other question, can you please provide a reference for the column-based shear retention model?
Column-based shear
retention model.
Retention. Yeah, it's it will be in the validation document, and either we will share the complete validation document if we can, or we will in the new version share only the basic validations into this model. And the column-based retention model. I think you're referring to a slide. Let's go there. You can, let's see. The shear retention model that's here on the bottom side. Can you still see my screen?
App?
Yes. Now you should be able to see my screen again.
Yes, we see your screen.
And here underneath the column-based shear retention model, and that's typically now linked and correlated with the university tests that are done with AU Center and the University of Delft. So what exact values to fill in here is clear for these tests. But of course, if you are at the other side of the world with another material and another brick-like material and another way of building, then you should correlate it with tests again. But this is typically normal Coulomb friction behavior, where you have initial cohesion, a sort of glue of your mortar, etc. And once that glue is gone, then you don't have the cohesion, the C anymore, and you only have your sliding friction depending on the stress normal to the plane. So.
Okay. Thanks, Seb. The other question, availability online. Yes, I think I can answer this question. Our target release for new version is sometime in third quarter this year. And we expect to include this engineering masonry model in our new version. I think we covered questions for now, and in case you have any other questions after the session, please send us an email, then we will get back to you. And I think then it's a good time to finish today's Diana webinar. Just one question. Would you available for a second if there's one more question regarding the further details of crack bandwidth definition in share used?
Well, the further definition of the Covingier option, maybe he or she is referring to, instead of the Jan Rots options, that's not limited to this Maestri model, but that will be available for all other total shear strain models as well. So it will be able to use it throughout the whole Diana model environment. And the typical difference is that the old model only took into account the average element size, and as I tried to explain, the new crack bandwidth will take into account the aspect ratio of the element. That's one thing, and the other thing is the tensile direction, principal direction. So that's much better, I think. I hope you can all take profit of it.
Thank you very much. All right, everyone, I think it's a good time to finish today's Diana webinar. We would like to extend our sincere appreciation to everyone who attend our session. After summer break season, we will be back with other interesting topics. Please subscribe our newsletter to get the latest update, including new webinar and our new enhancements and release. Thank you, everyone, and have a nice day.